I'm here with Abdoulaye Seck, who is the country manager for the World Bank for Burma. Mr. Seck, thank you very much for meeting with DVB today.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, and you've been in Burma for how long now?
I arrived here in early August and started this job in mid-September.
Excellent. And how are you liking it thus far?
I love it. This is a formidable country. I'm very happy to be here.
Great. Mm-hmm. So if you wouldn't mind giving the viewers a little bit of background on what the World Bank is and what it does around the world.
Yes, the World Bank Group is an organization that was set up by all countries around the world right after the Second World War, including obviously Myanmar as a shareholder. And our goal is to support countries around the world to eliminate extreme poverty and boost shared prosperity. So we are here in Myanmar, helping indeed the people of this country achieving those goals. And we want to do that, and it's extremely important, by ensuring sustainability, by which I mean sustainability on the social front, on the environmental front, and on the fiscal front.
And so in what ways is the bank currently engaging with the Burmese government, with the Burmese people?
We have started our operation here, as you may know. We resumed our operation in 2012. When we arrived in this country, that was a country in transition, we thought we will be supporting the transition. We thought along three lines. We thought it would be important to ensure that we will have new institutions that are more responsive to the people, that delivers services to the people. We thought we could help also in certainly building confidence in the transition, giving faith to people that this transition can work for everyone. And clearly, we were away for so long time, almost more than 25 years, so we thought it would be important for us to also prepare for a larger and a full re-engagement. Meaning basically that we needed to do a lot in terms of building our knowledge gap, for instance, understanding more the country, listening from the people, and which we have done.
Mm-hmm. Right. So what are some projects that you're particularly proud of that the World Bank is working on?
I think my first choice will come straight from the very first one we did, and I think it is a very important project on many grounds. This is a community-driven development project. That was the very first one we re-engaged with in Myanmar. And why it is important? I mean, this is a project, first of all, a government project, encouraging and promoting a new approach to development, not that top-down approach we have seen in the past that clearly had shown so much failures around, but a bottom-up approach, going to communities, empowering those communities, get them to organize themselves and identify what their needs are and get support to indeed build their infrastructure, be it schools, healthcare centers, bridge roads. Extremely important to encourage indeed governance at the local level, to encourage accountability. I visited a few villages around the country that got support from this project, looking at communities, how they were organized, how they could voice any concern about the project, how they could, for instance, use a grievance mechanism in place to report back that they are not very happy, or sometimes they are very happy, and I think most of the time they were extremely happy.
Back in December, the bank published the first comprehensive country diagnostic study for Burma. Mm-hmm. Would you mind telling me a little bit more about that, and also what the main structural impediments are to development in Burma?
Very important question, for which I thank you very much. You recall that I mentioned to you that we came in 2012. We needed to do a lot of things for a fuller re-engagement. And clearly, as mentioned to you, closing our knowledge gap was important. Having a chance to really talk with all stakeholders in the country, have consultation, and understanding what are the bottlenecks in Myanmar for those goals the World Bank Group would like to support in many countries, including in Myanmar. Elimination of extreme poverty and making sure that prosperity is shared. And we did then what we you call, I mean, the systematic country diagnostic. We look at carefully at the extent of poverty, the nature of poverty in Myanmar. We talk about, we saw that there were three groups of poor people in Myanmar, what we call the traditional poor, mostly in rural areas, farmers, landless laborers. And then the second group of poor, the transitional poor, those who left rural areas, come into peri-urban areas and are struggling finding indeed job outside the informal sector. And those third group of poor, basically the excluded poor, those who maybe by ethnic reason or other reason, cannot really participate to the economic social life, that excluded. And we thought that a pathway out of poverty would certainly target those different group of people differently. And we thought about two pathways. One clearly is about how to promote private sector developments, how to build the institutions for inclusive growth, job creation. This is one. And for which, with this pathway, those two first group of poor we mentioned earlier, those, for instance, in rural areas, farmers, and certainly those who are transitional poor, their main asset is their labor, their workforce. They can take advantage of this. But many other poor will not have the opportunity to do so because of conflict, violence, maybe ethnic reason. For those, what I think it is extremely important is to ensure that they have access to basic services. So the entire drive of what we do in the country will be to ensure inclusion through universal access to basic services. Everyone deserve and should have quality education, quality health. Mm-hmm. So that is pretty much what the systematic country diagnostic is saying. Right. And that will be used to inform our new country partnership framework, so our program for the next few years in Myanmar. That will be then taking the place after the interim strategy notes that we had in 2012.
So can you tell me a little bit more about how the bank is working to improve healthcare outcomes and education? Because I know this is something that sure. you were telling me that you sure. were very keen to highlight.
Sure. Clearly, very important point. I mean, again, our overarching objective in this country is to help eliminate extreme poverty and boost shared prosperity. And I mentioned to you those pathway to exit, to help poor people to get away from poverty. And education and health would be an important part of it, be it through a way to help citizens sure. get the skills they need to enter the labor job market, mm-hmm. or simply making sure that everyone has access to the basic services. So again, in these two sectors, the World Bank Group does support government programs. In the health sector, the program is basically about universal health coverage. Okay. Important, we want to support that. And in the education sector, making sure that we do support this decentralization of a fund transfers to the school, including stipend program for students. If you may allow me, just on the universal health coverage, it is very important agenda that basically has two components. One is really about access to basic services. Mm-hmm. And on that one, it was in October of last year, 2014, our board of directors approved a $100 million operation to mostly improve healthcare for moms, their babies, and children. And we expect that by the time this project will be fully implemented, there will be more than 4 million mothers and their children who will be benefiting from the support going to healthcare centers in all 230 townships of Myanmar. Sure. And the second component about financial protection, which is quite important for many poor households, sometimes illness is really the deciding factor in falling into poverty. They have a job, they fall sick, they cannot get into their job, and they lose a job, and so on. So how to help the country build a sustainable, viable financial protection scheme for when it comes to covering health costs. So it's very important, yeah.
One of the major pillars of the engagement of the bank here is education of, reform of Burma's education system, and working very closely with the ministry to bring about some of that change. If you could explain a little bit about how the World Bank is helping with.
There is something I would like to say that really always break my heart, which is when one consider kids in the poorest quintile, basically the 20% of poorest household in this country. By age 10, 20% of those young kids will have left school, and that is just not acceptable. And sometimes it's not best because they really want it. It's just a matter of trade-off. They can't afford to be in school when they need to earn income from the family.
Sure.
So basically now what this program is doing is to accompany the government in their decision to move very significantly more resources to the schools, which is this this is the school transfers program and the stipend program. And again, I want to stress in a transparent way, in an equitable way, in a way that is that bring efficiency and that also encourage accountability. So as a result of this program, by the time, this is an $80 million credit from the World Bank, in addition to a $20 million grant from the government of Australia, by the time this program will close, 8 million students will be in better schools, and we expect that 100,000 poor students will have stayed longer in schools than leaving. And as a result, they will get better education, they will get a better job tomorrow and higher income. So we are, this is a program we are extremely pleased supporting the government of Myanmar.
Sure.
We put a very strong monitoring and evaluation mechanism in there, like a spot check of how things did go, making sure that it is done, and how to
graph that local authorities aren't skimming off the top.
Spot check to identify any issues. Also, annual survey with schools, with parents, with the community to see how things goes.
Yeah.
And so also, I think a lot of openness and transparency. So to tell the stakeholders that if there are concerns, they can report this concern. And this is what your viewers could see from the infographics we share with you.
Yeah, absolutely. That's great. Is there any, for example, are there any conditions attached to the World Bank's engagement with the education sector?
We have a long-haul engagement in the education sector. This very first program we are active in is to support this effort of bringing resources away from the center all the way down to the schools level where services are given to students.
Sure.
So this is the very first part of our program. But clearly we are here for the long haul. We discuss a lot about how to, for instance, ensure that our program is a conflict sensitive, how we can ensure that as part of what we do, we support, I mean, this peace process going forward.
Mm-hmm.
And the way we support Myanmar government across many sectors, we stress the result. Our support will come when we see results. We have this concept of result-based financing.
Sure.
So we measure progress, we see progress, and then we release resources.
But of course, the government here has a lot of money at its disposal. Military budgets are still very high and have not dropped. So why is the World Bank underwriting all of these things when the government has the tools at its disposal to do so? Are you not kind of giving them a pass on this?
Let me explain a few things we do to support government in making sure that the budget is responsive to the people of Myanmar. You know, what was the very first major work we have done in terms of building knowledge, closing this knowledge gap I mentioned earlier, is to assess the quality of public expenditure and financial accountability in this country. We have this standardized global benchmarking, we call it the PEFA. And that gave us a basis of how indeed Myanmar is doing in terms of accounting for the revenue coming to this country, how it does in terms of planning for the budget, how it does for implementing a budget, reporting on the budget, auditing on the budget. And clearly, yes, they did not do very well. But the most important thing is not the baseline, it's the direction. And so what we did together with many other partners, including government of Australia, the government of UK, was to then to get together and see how we can support Myanmar with a public financial management project. So to make sure that the government activities and programs are responsive to the citizen through a better public financial management. So that is an ongoing program. I think it's going relatively well. Very, very pleased with the effort and what is going on, working with not only government, but also with parliament, working with Auditor General. And of course, we are very pleased that Myanmar has agreed to join the EITI, as you know, very important initiative to shed light on what are the revenue coming to this country, and ensuring that those revenues will go to the citizens. So there is a program, I think, for the good of the people, and this is what the World Bank stands for the good of the people. And when I think all our program could track and trace to the ultimate two goals I did mention. I think I would like to stress again how we are committed to the people of Myanmar. I think they have unique opportunities, I think, to catch up with a very large potential this country has, and we will be working and continue working to support the transition Myanmar is going through, the transition to peace, the transition to market economies, ones that create jobs for everyone, ones that certainly will lead to poverty reduction, and also making sure that when the tide rise, I mean, all boat will be lifted.
Mr. Seck, thank you very much for your
time. Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
All right.